Kyle Bohannon with another episode of the Art of Physical Fitness Show. Today, we're here with an interview with Zach Moore. Zach, go ahead and introduce yourself, tell us a little bit about your background, and why the people listening should give a crap about what you have to say.
All right, thanks, Kyle, for bringing me on here. Yeah, as Kyle said, my name is Zach Moore. I'm a strength coach at Indianapolis Fitness and Sports Training. It's co-owned by Mike Robertson and Bill Hartman. And I've been working there for a little over 2 years now. I guess August of 2010 was when I first started. And then I also have a website, zmoore.com. And I just write about, you know, a lot of coaching stuff, you know, because that's what I do at IFAST. You know, I'm on the floor all the time. So, you know, ways to get people in good position, motivate them, nutrition, you name it. It's just my passion. So.
What's your typical client base that you work with, or genre, if you will, that you work with personally?
It's largely general pop people. To be honest, I have anywhere from, you know, I have a 11-year-old soccer player to an 80-year-old doctor I work with. So it's very diverse. Mm-hmm. I would say a large percentage of our clients come to us because they have been in pain or they are in pain. That's one of the things we're kind of known for.
Okay.
You know, improving people's movement, and just getting people out of pain.
Now, being that it is, I have my own gym here in Cincinnati, Strive, and right now it's all high school and junior high kids, and some as young as 10, 11, like you're talking about. Now, do you mold it, you guys have it where those 8-year-old clients are working out at the same time as your 11-year-old soccer player, or is it more sectioned off into different times of the day?
No, it's basically the way we're set up is a semi-private model. So I, as a trainer, can handle 4 people at one time. And it may be that I have that 11-year-old and that 80-year-old doctor in the same session.
Okay. So being at IFAST, obviously with Mike there, a lot to learn from him. What has been your biggest takeaway so far in the past 2 years?
Oh, yeah, that's a big one. I guess probably just how much I still have to learn. I mean, those guys push me, you know, every day just to learn more. I mean, if you walk into IFAST and you go into our library, I mean, every single book you can think of, they have. And it's just, I mean, it's exciting, but at the same time, you know, it can be overwhelming. Mm-hmm. But I guess just how complex the body is. I mean, like I said, a lot of people we have come to us that are in pain. And just when I was first getting into this field, you know, I thought it was just as simple as, well, you know, look at the movement and you can usually determine if one thing is weak, one thing, you know, is tight, you know, stuff like that. But we've just, one of the biggest things we've started implementing here recently, or not recently, quite a while actually, is just breathing stuff. And I've seen some pretty amazing stuff with that. Like we've taken some baseball pitchers who have almost no internal rotation and done a couple breathing drills and bam, you know, they have full IR back. Just crazy stuff like that. So I guess that's one of the more geeky things.
Now is that from moving them from a position of more, make it simple, chest breathing to more stomach breathing in simple terms?
A little bit. It has more to do with kind of realigning the rib cage.
Okay.
So a lot of people think, you know, if someone doesn't have IR in their shoulder, then maybe the backside of the shoulder is stiff or something like that. Mm-hmm. But it can also be that the rib cage is not positioned well, so the scapula doesn't set right, and then they're just kind of, you know, banging on that. So it's just kind of manipulating the rib cage and stuff like that. But anyways, that's kind of some geeky stuff. But outside of that, I think also another big takeaway I've had the longer I coach is just how little that actually – science stuff does to get people results. So like when I first started out in the field, like one of the big things I did was I read a ton of anatomy, physiology, biomechanics, things like that.
Right.
And you know, it's one thing, you know, you may get a client, say a fat loss client, and you know exactly what they need to do to get their results. Like, you know exactly the program they need to do, you know exactly what they need to eat. But if you cannot get that client to follow your steps, then that's just a, you know,
right.
I'm not going to say it's a waste, but, you know, it's not going to get them what they need. So the longer I've coaching, actually, the more I've kind of started to read more into, like psychology and behavior change, stuff like that. So it's just, like I said, a lot of people, I think, that think of being a trainer, you know, they don't always imagine that stuff. You know, it's just about, you know, knowing the science, the writing the programs, things like that. But it's just, I mean, that's why I love it, though.
Yeah,
I
mean, I'm the same way.
Things, so.
Absolutely. That kind of takes me to the next question. You kind of briefly touched on it, but let's go into it. When someone comes to you fresh off the street, whatever they're, obviously, it all depends on the host of conditions that they could have. But how would you approach them for just very initially a physical standpoint, but also getting them to buy into the program and doing what they need to do mentally?
So everyone that starts out at IFAS gets a pretty thorough assessment. Usually that's done by Bill, our physical therapist, and one of the owners. It's usually about an hour. And then based on that assessment, he gives me a problems list of kind of their limitations, weaknesses. And then I take that along with the person's goals, and then I write them like an individualized program based on those things. And that program is just, it's just a template at first. I mean, it gives us a starting point, but then once I actually get on the floor with the client, that program could, I mean, it could completely change, you know, because like I said, so much of it depends on the person, you know, what do they enjoy?
Right.
You know, why, you know, I mean, it may be that they want to lose fat, but, you know, maybe they hate, you know, doing cardio or something like that. You know, I mean, there's just little tweaks that you can make. So it's all about, you know, making the person be consistent, making them, or, you know, getting them to buy into what you're doing. And I think that's largely just getting them to trust you. So you really have to show them that you care about them. You know, when they come in, greet them, you know, make them seem like they're the best part of your day, you know, because again, I think a big part of seeing results is really getting the person to trust you and the process behind it. So like I said, that first program, you know, I really look at, you know, the problems list and then look at their goals. And a lot of times, like I said, we get people in pain. So it's unfortunate that there are some things we can't, you know, go straight into the big bang exercises that can be fun.
Right.
So really you train what you can, and then, you know, you kind of work around the other limitations.
Now, what are some of right off the bat, first actually go back to the second part of that question, the mental side, getting them to buy into the program.
Mm-hmm.
What do you, obviously a lot of them just come in and they're ready to do it, but some, like I find myself, especially with younger kids that I'm dealing with, it's tough for them to buy into the program. So how do you go about, from the psychological standpoint?
I think a big part is educating them just on the process, like why it is important.
Mm-hmm.
I think another big thing is really determining what their biggest limiting factors are to their goals. So again, if you know, if we have someone who, say, is a fat loss client, you know, one of the first things I have them do is just write down maybe a 3 to 5 day food log for me.
Okay.
And then we'll kind of go through that food log, and I'll have them write down, you know, what do you think is your biggest, you know, the kind of the biggest limiting factor on that food log. So they may rate that, you know, like 1 to 10, you know, what is probably doing the worst for my goals. And then I'll also have them rank that, you know, in confidence level, like 1 to 10, how confident are you that you can eliminate this? And so based on that, you know, we can really determine, you know, what is going to be easy for them to give up, and also what is going to have the biggest impact on their goal. So, you know, you may look at someone's food log, for example, and see right away that, oh, they're drinking Coke. Well, that can be an easy thing for them to cut out. So, you know, that may be your first step. But what if they love Coke? Like, what that may be, like, totally right there. You tell them that, nope, they don't want to do it.
Yeah.
So there may be something else, you know, that you can really look at. So I think that's a good way, again, is kind of determining, you know, kind of people's limiting factors. And again, just showing them how much you care. Like I said, every time they come in, smile, you know, greet them. You know, I'm in contact with most of my clients, not just in the gym, but outside of it. Like, I maintain a close relationship with all of them. You know, I invite them out to coffee occasionally, you know, stuff like that. Again, it's getting them to, you know, really trust you and the process.
So when those first people come to you, obviously you have the assessment from Mike, or not always Mike, but Bill, and for all the stuff in the first assessment, what are some questions that you always address that you feel like you always are kind of asking yourself when it comes down to actually doing the programming?
So again, it's what does this person need, and then what does this person want? And you kind of have to learn to mold those two things. So let's say I have a problems list. One of the best ways one of the ways I start writing out a program is maybe I have, some problems like, limited ankle mobility, limited shoulder mobility, lack of thoracic spine rotation, something like that. So I'll list those out. And then next to that, I'll write down, like foam rolling. And then I'll write down, maybe some mobility stuff. And then I'll write down strength training. And so in each category, I'll try to address like each limitation. If it's ankle mobility, we may do something like foam roll the calves. We may do something like, ankle mobs in the warm up. And then, we may go into like squats or something, to kind of take advantage of that increased mobility we've gained. Something like that. But again, I also want to know, what do they want? What is their goal? And so really that may not sound like much, but really those are the biggest questions I ask. I also consider, what the person's done before they've come here, how many days a week do they want to train? What's their injury history? Basically that's it.
All right. So, let's kind of shift the focus a little bit onto your side of the equation. How do you training personally?
I've kind of been playing around here recently. I actually I went on a vacation probably 3 months ago or so.
Where to?
And for that, I was just so focused on getting stronger. Like everything I did was, I'm gonna lift, I'm gonna set a PR this week. Like I'm gonna lift, as hard as I can. And I kind of got away from my own form and kind of doing the stuff that I preach. So since I've gotten back, I've actually kind of almost started into like a bodybuilding-ish type of program just to change things up. Like, it seems like a lot of people kind of hate on bodybuilding training so much these days. It's not functional. It's da-da-da. They're not trying to get strong. But, I'm still trying to get strong. It's just, I'm kind of controlling the motion a little better. I'm not so focused on how much weight is on the bar. I'm always trying to increase that weight, but I'm letting my ego go aside a bit. And I'm just having fun with it. Like, it's really fun, honestly. Like, I don't know how long it'd been since I'd done like a bicep curl.
Right.
And I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. Like, I don't know why people hate on that. Like, there's nothing wrong with that at all. So basically I just do an upper lower split. So it's not really bodybuilder-ish, but so 4 days a week, two upper, two lower. And mainly I usually have like two main compound movements, and then I'll follow that up with maybe, four assistance lifts or something higher rep. And the two main movements are usually, it depends, 4 to 8 rep range usually. So I'm always trying to increase my strength on that. And then the assistance lifts, it's more just, like I said, having fun and getting a pump.
Love getting a pump. Now, with that said, did you train your nutrition at all based on knowing that you're going to have more volume and might have to eat a little more to compensate, or did you just your training change in nutrition?
Yeah, that's actually something I've been experimenting a little bit too. I was kind of on the low-carb approach for quite a while. I mean, I'd always have carbs after training and stuff like that. But I recently found out that I actually have hypothyroidism, so I have a pretty sluggish thyroid. And so I've actually been experimenting with going a little bit higher of a carb approach, not just because of the higher volume training, but also just, I've read some up on some stuff, and it seems the high carbs can be pretty effective in kickstarting the thyroid a little bit in your metabolism. And I've really been feeling good with it. I mean, again, it's kind of one of those things out there where so many people are huge on the low carb, and I think it could be great for a lot of people. Don't get me wrong. Like, I'm still a fan of that for a lot of people, but that's one of the ways, just bumping up calories by increasing my carbohydrates, basically.
Now, what kind of indicated to you that you might need to check out your thyroid, or is it just something you find out through another test and just circumstance type deal? Or
I think it's pretty important for people to get blood work done, pretty comprehensive blood work, every couple of years. So that's all I did, is I had it checked out, and They found that, so I just decided that, you know, I needed to address it, obviously. But that's one thing I try to get my clients to do. I mean, it can be pricey, but just so important to figure out, you know, ways to, you could be doing everything right outside of that. And, you know, if a hormone is, you know, lacking, you know, man has low testosterone or, like I said, sluggish thyroid, something like that, and it's going to be really hard to get the results you want. So I think that, I mean, obviously you want to go, there's nutritional strategies then you can implement to try to improve that, like that. So it really gives you, you know, a good guide as to what you need to do.
Now, going back to the whole bodybuilding approach you're doing now, but not so much talking about the bodybuilding, how have you found yourself to, obviously this is one way to kind of break the mundane of the training that sometimes it can be, but how do you not allow your training to control the whole aspect? I know my path in my life, training controlled everything, diet controlled everything, 2-hour eating, everything was planned around it. But obviously that's not very sustainable as far as happy life, if you will. So how do you personally have it control with, how it fit into the big picture of things?
Yeah, that's been hard for me to figure out. I'm actually have gotten a lot better at it. I think it's just realizing the longer you train, realizing that missing one session here or there is not going to like make you wither away and, you know, lose all your gains. I think that's one of the things that's helped me the most, is just realizing that. And one other thing, this is one thing that I do just to make sure that, you know, training doesn't rule me, because I can go into the gym and, like I said, it's my hobby. Like it's
right.
Something I enjoy. It kind of makes it hard because, you know, I also work in the gym, but training itself is my hobby. So I could spend a lot of time in there, but normally I need to start training clients at about 2 p.m. So I'll go in there at about 11:30 or 12, knowing that I need to train, I need to eat, and I need to shower, like all before that 2 p.m. So that makes sure that I stay on track and that, you know, I don't waste a bunch of time in there. So that's one way. And, again, I will never harp on clients. Like if they, you know, need to miss the session or saying, you know, they'll lose all the results because of that, like family, friends, stuff like that is more important than your training. I mean, it's just consistency over the long run. I think that's the other thing that's helped me realize, you know, just as long as I can get in there, you know, and be consistent, then it's okay. And nutrition, I think any strategy can work. I think one thing that's helped the strength training community is kind of just getting rid of the idea that you need to eat every, you know, 2 to 3 hours. Mm-hmm. To see results. I think that's really helped people, you know, just kind of eat when you're hungry. It's not a big deal if you eat, you know, 2 meals a day versus 8 meals a day. Cause I know a couple of years ago I tried to do that, you know, eating every 2 to 3 hours, and it just takes up so much time. So, I mean, if that works for a person, I think that's great. But again, that's not needed, and that's definitely freed up some time for me as well.
Yeah. Now, do you do, obviously you talk about your carb, as far as your hypothyroidism, do you now do any of the cycling or intermittent fasting or carb backloading, anything like that, or now it's just pretty much you eat throughout the day with what you need?
I don't like to really talk about this, but I actually do intermittent fasting. The reason I don't like to talk about it very much is I just feel like it's almost been put on a pedestal, like it's the ultimate magic pill for people. And I think just some people are getting so extreme with it in terms of, you know, oh, I'm now at 36 hours fast and, you know, I can't wait, you know, after 48 hours, I'm going to go and have like 3 pizzas and
waiting for the clock to hit noon. You're 11:59. You're sitting there waiting.
Yeah, exactly. And, I mean, I've talked with some people about this, but I mean, there's a ton of people on Facebook, and I actually had a post on this too. It's just, you know, I think intermittent fasting can be great, but I don't think it's like the magic pill. And again, I don't use it so I can eat, you know, garbage food. And again, there are people out there that are struggling with their weight. And when they see stuff like that, you know, that again goes back to the simplicity. Like that makes them question things. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, they haven't eaten for 36 hours. I just ate, you know, I better not eat for the next hour. And, you know, and then they see them eating, you know, they post pictures of, like I said, pizza or ice cream, this huge meal. And then they're like, well, if they're eating that, I can eat that. You know, I mean, it's just, it's confusing people, I think. I mean, the idea was to simplify it, but.
Yeah. Why do you think it is that way? I mean, I guess you can think of examples outside of just fitness and nutrition and all that. Why do you think it is that we can tire, sometimes myself, but a lot in the past, where we tire ourselves so much to the dogma and tire, again, the 2 to 3 times meals a day, or every 2 to 3 hours. When I used to do that, if I missed a meal, I was freaking out. That's the deal. Why do you think we it's gotten to that point in the industry where people tie themselves so much to these things one way or the other, without gray areas, without flexibility?
Well, I think it's again, like fasting, for example. It was a new thing. It was a new topic. So, you know, if you could get on that bandwagon first, like people that were informing people about it, you know, they were like, oh, this is new. You know, I can get this information out here. It's a little bit, you know, it's controversial. So that can get me, you know, more traffic, da, da, da. And I'm not harping. I mean, I think the people that are putting out that information are very, very smart. You know, mm-hmm. Mark Birkin, Kiefer, you know, Brad Pilon. I think they're very smart guys. But, you know, then slowly people saw that, you know, that information, and more people just started writing on it more and more. And so we just see it everywhere we go. And then, you know, we think it's, again, like the magic pill. Oh, I haven't tried that, you know, then maybe that's the missing piece. So, you know, I need to try it. And for a while, you know, the 5 to 6 meals, that was the thing. You know, everyone was preaching, you have to do this to lose fat. You have to do this to lose fat. And now I feel like it's the fasting thing. And again, it's just everyone's just searching for that. You know, that easy way out. I feel I shouldn't say everyone. I don't mean everyone, but
right.
A lot of people are just searching for that easy way out, and it's just something they haven't tried. And I think that's the biggest reason.
So let's kind of go back so that we can get a bigger picture of Zach Moore and where he came from first, and then tie it all together with how your ideas and philosophies have changed. How did you get into what interested you initially to get into training? Just from not even personal training perspective, even before that, what got you into it?
Like training myself personally, or
yeah,
training. Okay, so I was trained in high school. I played football in high school, and so it was mandatory to lift weights, so I lifted weights a lot then. And then when I got into college, I actually played tennis in college, and weights were not mandatory. I mean, we did no weight training at all, hardly. It was mainly just conditioning, things like that. So I completely got away from it. But then I actually had in between there, I think it was in between before my freshman year of college, I had knee surgery on my right knee. And then after, I think 2008, after my sophomore year of undergrad, I had my second knee surgery on the same knee. And basically after that surgery, it was still had poor knee function, and basically the doctors told me that I should stay away from all running, I should stay away from tennis, I should stay away from any ballistic activity at all.
For a period?
No, for good. I have very little cartilage on the outside of my knee, and so when they told me that, I was just like, you know, I'm not accepting that. Like I'm gonna find a way to improve my knee, because I can't, you know, I love tennis, I love being active. So basically from there, I just read as much as I could about knees, how to improve my knee function. And essentially I stumbled across Mike Robertson's Bulletproof Knees manual. And I started actually following some of the stuff in that. We had a little bitty gym in my apartment at the time. So that's when I kind of slowly started getting back into, you know, some weights, things like that. And then I actually realized that Mike had a gym in the city I lived in Indianapolis. So I actually went up there, visited him. I remember actually driving up to IFAST, and I saw him through the window, and I thought he was like the most famous. I mean, he was like a celebrity to me. I was so nervous. But anyways, I know Mike really well now, and that's just funny to say that. But so anyways, I go in, and I actually became a client at IFAST for about a year. And during that time, I mean, again, they took me through the whole assessment, like they wrote a program for me. And I mean, after a year, I had virtually no knee pain whatsoever, and I could do pretty much anything I wanted. And my knee does not hurt. I mean, 3 years later, my knee does not hurt at all. I mean, I can't think of anything that will irritate it right now. So that's essentially what got me back into weight training. But like I said, I weight trained a lot in high school. I was actually born with only one arm. So I'm missing half of my right arm at the elbow.
Really?
Yeah. So a lot of stuff in high school was just, I did a lot of bench pressing, incline bench pressing, shoulder pressing with my left arm only. I did very little stuff with my right arm. The coaches didn't think I could squat, so I just did leg press, leg extension, things like that. But when I got to IFAST, they really helped me find ways to do other things. So now I've created a bunch of implements and gadgets to help me do pretty much any lift. And so that's really helped improve the, asymmetries I've had in my body. And I think a lot of that was causing my knee pain as well, just, favoring one side. And
right.
Just one side of my core was way overdeveloped, things like that. So it's been stuff like that out.
I'm interested in these implements. Like, I'm probably one thing, I'm just guessing, safety squat bar you probably use.
Yes.
Yeah. But what are some of these other implements that you say you've created?
So I didn't really create, well, I guess I did. I actually have a truck strap.
Okay.
On my right shoulder to deadlift with.
Oh, wow.
So I have a YouTube channel, and I have some deadlifts. I've actually figured out a way to like power clean. Another thing I use is I don't know if you've seen like the wrist straps with hooks on them.
Yeah.
We're going to use for deadlift. I actually put that around my right arm, and I can hold dumbbells. And then I have like a little, so I have that can hold on to dumbbells. And then also if I need to lengthen it a little bit, I have a little, it's called like a links chain. And so I can actually use that, and I can do like chin ups, cause it makes my arms the same length.
Right.
So I can bench press, cause like I said, with the dumbbell, I can do kettlebell swings. So that makes my arms the same length. But yeah, if you go to my YouTube channel, I have a bunch of kind of interesting, little
awesome.
Tricks.
Yeah, I'll definitely go check it out, and I'll put a link to your YouTube channel below the video. Going back to your knee pain and your getting the IFAST for it, what were some of the things that, obviously, you've probably done a multiple of things to address it, but what do you feel like would probably have the biggest thing for your butt?
Well, basically, like I said, I just have no cartilage on the lateral side of my knee. So as long as my knee was tractioning well, I mean, like when I was going into flexion, straightening and bending it, as long as, my mechanics were good, I would have no pain. But it was just the large part was my hips were so weak that, if I ever went to cut or sprint or anything like that, just I would get this, I would get this cave in my knee, and then, I'd get a rubbing of the bone. And that's basically what was happening, is on the lateral side, the bones were rubbing together, and the bone was actually splintering apart a little bit. So once, I just learned to really control my knee function, my knee motion, I did a lot of single leg stuff, even squat. I mean, I did squatting right away and had no pain as long as, again, my knee was in a good position.
Mm-hmm.
So ultimately just strengthening my hips and strengthening the muscles that control my knee position. That was the biggest thing. And I mean, it was a gradual process. I mean, I'm not going to lie, if there was ever a time, if, for example, if I was squatting, my knee caved a little bit, my knee would hurt for, 2 weeks, and I thought I was back to square one.
Right.
But that's why you have to be patient, consistent. And, I trusted the whole process. I mean, Mike and Bill were great to address any questions I had and stuff like that.
Now, as a member of IFAST, when you're a client there, do you just work with your trainer after the assessment, everything is done like that? Do you specifically work with your trainer, or is also, is it molded into your membership or whatever you want to call it, with work with physical therapists if you have issues like that? Is it all one package? How does it all come together?
So we have different packages based on how many times a week you want to work with a coach. And all of our clients, like I said, no matter what, get an assessment with Bill initially, and then all of our clients get a reassessment every 3 months with him as well. And then he does, he will check on them occasionally if they're having pain and stuff like that, but we do not accept insurance or anything like that. It is all kind of part of the membership. And then every one of our clients has to work with a coach at least once a week. So kind of the membership rates vary based on if you want to work with a coach once a week, twice a week,
right,
4 times a week. That's basically you either work with me, or I'm kind of the afternoon guy, and then the Saturday guy, and then we have a morning guy. And then we also usually have 2 or 3 interns around, and that's usually how it works. So,
Before we start wrapping this thing up, I want to kind of address the life picture of it all. How has your fitness life, your training life, your life at IFAB, how has it impacted your life outside of all that?
It's great. I love my job. Like, I'm so blessed. I don't know if you know this either, but I actually, right before I started my job at IFAST, I was getting my master's degree, and I was actually getting in economics. So I do not have a degree in exercise science or anything like that. And the only reason I went to grad school was, like, senior year, first semester, one of my professors wrote on my test, "Have you ever considered grad school?" And he's like, "You know, I think we can get you a scholarship." So I was like, "Okay, you know, I'll do that, since I don't know at all what I want to do." So I went into grad school. Like I said, I became a client at IFAST probably during that first year. And my whole second year of my master's program, I was just studying anatomy and physiology and biomechanics. Like, I knew that's what I wanted to do, but I was like, I'm just going to go ahead and finish this master's program.
Right.
I was not happy. I mean, you know, in economics, and I thought it was all about just, you know, I just needed to find a job where I could be, you know, that it was stable and it was secure and things like that. And I'm so much happier. Just, I mean, I found something I'm so passionate about, and I just encourage everyone to do that. I mean, you know, if there's something you're passionate about, do not be afraid to pursue it. Like, go after it, because it will make all the difference in the world. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think that's the biggest impact it's had. Just, it's changed me as a person, because I'm now just so much happier. And I mean, I work a lot, but it's just because I love it. You know, I'm constantly trying, I'm thinking about ways, you know, I can help my clients, get, you know, more educated. You know, I love reading about the stuff. And it's just, it doesn't even seem like work to me. You know, I just, yeah.
If you had a name, 3 of your top books on training and all that, what would they be? I know, limiting the 3 is tough. It'd be tough for me too.
I should know this. I mean, I feel like I've had to answer this before. I love Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers by Robert Spokane. I think it's a great one on stress, just understanding the process of stress and managing it. This is not really a book, but I mean, any trainer has access to this. There's something called the PRI, Postural Restoration Institute. I've been lucky enough, because Bill has taken the courses, Mike has taken the courses, they offer courses, and I've been lucky enough to kind of read through the manual and learn from that. If you have a chance, if you're a trainer, I would definitely highly recommend checking out their stuff.
The PRI.com, what is that under?
I think it's Postural Restoration Institute.
Okay.
It's Nebraska. It's excellent. I mean, a lot of gyms are actually starting to get into it. Eric Cressy implements a lot of their stuff.
Okay.
Boyle just went to the PRI stuff and thinks it could be huge. But some of the breathing stuff I was talking about earlier with pitchers and stuff like that, some of the stuff I learned from them, great, great resource. Like, it's like magic. I mean, it's amazing stuff. So we've had huge success. Like I said, we've had people with back pain for years, and they come in, we give them like one drill, and bam, they don't feel it anymore. So I won't get into that too much, but that's an excellent resource. I would highly recommend to everyone. And then third one, how about, give me a topic.
You gave a stretch one, you gave an exercise one. Let's a business one. You're reading on business? I don't know if you read much business books.
Cool. Yep. This is the first one that popped. I like Think and Grow Rich. I think that one's really good.
Absolutely. Love that one.
Awesome. Have you read that
one? Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Read it, listen to it on audiobook, and all that good stuff. Love that book.
Yeah, that's a really good one. So I'll say that.
So before we go, what does the future hold for Zach Moore and zmoore.com? What are you trying to get across? What are you, for people who are interested in checking out your site?
So my main focus is I'm actually kind of originally when I first started my blog, my aim was just to kind of write about what I was learning at IFAST as a new coach. So I was talking a lot about kind of the geeky stuff, you know, I was telling you about, you know, ways to coach people, get people in good positions, things like that. I'm kind of just changed my focus a little bit here recently, just to kind of simplify things. Actually, I feel like there are a lot of good people out there if you want to learn about the geekier stuff. You know, I mean, we have the Mike Robertsons, Eric Cressy's, Bill Hartman's, you know, and their stuff is excellent. But I've just learned that that's not really what I'm most passionate about. Like, I love being on the floor and, like I said, kind of the psychology and just simplifying things for people. I feel like there's just so much confusion out there. You know, like I was talking about intermittent fasting, 6 meals a day, you know, carb backloading, you know, there's a zillion things and they can work, but you know, I just want to be kind of the voice of reason and kind of, you know, clear some of that confusion and, again, give people the most basic advice to get them started. Because I think that there's – to get people from basically a almost no fitness to a good level of fitness does not require these magic, you know, crazy things, right? So I want to take that person who – they're scared to go into the gym. You know, they don't have confidence. They're confused because they've read so much. They're, you know, they're overwhelmed. I want to be able to take that person, give them simple steps to get to a good level of fitness, you know, where, you know, again, it doesn't revolve, their life doesn't revolve around it. And they're just happy. They're healthy. They're happy. And so kind of like I was saying, my audience largely is women. That's largely who I work with. And so that's who I've kind of started gearing towards is women. I think they're the ones that are almost the most confused, and they're kind of seems like a lot of them are on a poor path to kind of see the results they're after. And a lot of it's just due to poor information and confusion. So like I said, I want to simplify the steps as much as possible. And I'm actually in the process of writing an ebook on how to get started lifting weights.
Yeah, I saw your post, your part one post of it the other day. I read through that. It was a good post.
Yeah, yeah. So I feel like, again, there's a lot of information out there about, you know, sexy programs to try and all this, but there's just so little information about how do you actually get started? Like how, if someone's in their home right now, how could they get started, you know, if they, you know, if they don't want to use a trainer or, you know, something like that. So, or even if they do have a trainer, I think it could be a resource for trainers to get people started from ground zero.
Right.
You know, if trainers get a brand new person, you know, what do they do with them? So I think it could be a great resource for them as well. So I'm working on that. I'm also looking to pursue a nutrition cert here soon. Nutrition is another one, another topic I'm very passionate about. And then I just want to continue rocking out at IFAST, continue to help it grow, expand, and yeah, hopefully we can dominate.
Awesome. Well, Zach, I once again thank you for coming on to the show. I wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year, but I definitely will not be a stranger on Facebook, so I'll be in touch with you. Until next time, everyone, this is Kyle again with the Art of Physical Fitness Show. You can check out Zach at zmoore.com, and I'll have a link for your YouTube channel as well down below the interview if you want to access that to check out the videos he was talking about. But again, until next time, I will talk to you later, and I thank you again, Zach.